Hey guys, welcome to the finals here. I think we're going to keep this on the play. The main reasoning being that if we find, like, any third land, even if it's not the second black for Phyrexian Arena, then we can at least play this Born Power Stone, and then that'll get us up into 4-drop territory. And then there's a chance that we just play Arena on 3, and that would be pretty good too. Knew it. You're always supposed to shuffle. Always draw land after the shuffle. Such superstition. Yeah, this is a rough time. Yeah, technically our odds are just way worse, but it's whatever. I want to devour this in shadow. Hey, we found a play. And looks loose in retrospect, but I mean, 2-lander's on the play, right? And this wasn't any 2-lander, it was a 2-lander with Born Power Stone and Phyrexian Arena. So if we do hit, like, our odds of winning are pretty strong. It's hard to lose after going turn 3 Arena. This board just got scary, though. I don't think we even play Arena. I think it's going to be hard to come up with the mana to cast the cards that we already have. So I'm just going to play Power Stone here. I'm not going to devour in shadow either. Like, he already has plenty of mana thanks to the wake. So I'm going to attack. Next turn, hopefully, I'll hit another land drop so I can go either Pia and Kieran plus devour in shadow or just run out Godo. Try and race that way. A lot depends on what his actual gas is in hand, because this isn't gas. This is just a ton of mana. It's like an actual ton of mana. He can do whatever it is that he wants to do with this Mirari's Wake in play. But he does only have 4 cards in hand. So if his remaining juice is like another couple of ramp spells and a creature, and we like kill the creature, then it could be in good shape. Looks like he's tapping a lot of mana though, so good chance of something scary happening here. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 mana. Seek. Okay. Sure thing, buddy. What you gonna get? He's gonna get information. That's what he's gonna get. He doesn't get to see my hand. Yeah, this is kind of interesting. I'm not sure if I would ever play this card in limited, because the life gain isn't that important. In this format, people tend to get murdered before they get a chance to play all of their cards too, so it's a little bit dubious as to like taking the best card out of your opponent's deck. I'm not sure how good that effect is. Who knows, though? Like I said, this is just my second draft. The other one is put target artifact or enchantment bottom of its opponent's library. So that's a pretty good one to target my Born Power Stone, and then he could have Lumog blown something up. Looks like I'm just going to die to the Annihilator, because this thing is indestructible and we don't have an edict, so. Alright. Well, that looked pretty good. Turn 2, Marble Diamond. Turn 3, Sashi. Turn 4, Mirari's Wake. Turn 5, Ulamog. Yeah, it's pretty solid. Yeah, I see he played his Search effect before he played his Ulamog to, like, make sure that he got to see my deck before I conceded. Pretty sharp. I like this against him. Once again, I'm porting out Godo. I had Godo be really good in the last deck that I drafted, but that deck also had equipments that actually pumped your creatures, whereas Basilisk Collar is more of a combo-y card, and I haven't actually been able to combine it with, like, Mono or something to machine gun down the opponent's cards. So it hasn't looked the best. That doesn't do anything. That doesn't do any- none of these cards do anything. Yeah, I hate all of these cards. I'm just gonna submit. I feel like we need to apply pressure in this matchup. This hand can do that. Yeah, we're just missing like a 3-drop or something. So that's what I'm going to be scrying towards, slash just like any burn. Oh, hey. Whoa, look at this curve. Opponent fetches Arid Mesa. Again, turn two Marble Diamond. Our hand's a little bit better at actually applying pressure this time around, though. We can actually trigger Liliana next turn if that's a thing that we want to do. And then Pia can also sack to trigger the Liliana. Ooh, that's a good one. Probably just exiles Liliana here. Sure. No blocking for me. So we can get through a decent amount of blockers, and we have a decent amount of reach here. So it's looking like we're going to be able to force a game three. Gift of the Gargantuan. I don't think I care about that card. No, I don't. I had it in my pool for my last deck, and ended up not playing it. 3 mana to look at the top 4 cards of your library. Not very exciting. It might be that he just has to run so many ramp spells for his deck to work that he needs the gift to like filter through so he can find his bits of gas to end the game with. That might be his reasoning. Oh wow. Let's see, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. That is game. The old turn 5. And the no-nonsense win condition. Not even waiting for the next main phase. What do we want to change? Anything? I still like the Word of Seizing. Seems really good. It seems really good against an Eldrazi anyway. It's like pretty cute with Timurei. Word of Seizing, take your Eldrazi, sacrifice it. Or like Goggles, copy it twice. Does the thing destroy it? Yeah. So because his Eldrazi has indestructible, Hirobi's not going to really be an answer to that. We would need to... Well, I guess Lizolda can sacrifice creatures, too. The creatures don't have to be black or red to sacrifice them. As we found out with Pia and Kirin Nalar, you can certainly sacrifice colorless creatures if that's something that you want to do. I'm just thinking if there's anything that we want to change here. I don't think there is. Cezanne is some pretty good pressure, but it's kind of expensive too. But it might be better than like Kumano in this matchup. Like, he's just not killing much. And this guy domes the opponent. Alright, I'll try that. I'll try it out. I'll try it. Give it the old college 1-2. Draw on that fiery thicket. So this hand is way worse than the last one, but still have some stuff. Still have some things that we can do. Hank just got way better, I think. Yeah, okay. One problem with that Phyrexian Arena is that it's not actually pressure. So I'm not sure if I want to spend my turn 3 playing it when I could be playing like Lizolda or something. Lidarmory's Call, sure. Tutors of Sashi. Can't play her. Play Seek again. Some people really like that card. Oh, maybe he just doesn't have access to red mana. That's like the only half that he can play Seek as. We do deal a decent amount of damage in burn, so... Just play Seek, gain 6 life. Not the worst for 2 mana, I suppose. Yeah, the more that I think about it, the less bad that it seems. So he's going to be playing Sashi on turn 3, so we definitely don't want to go like turn 3 Liliana here. Going turn 3 Liliana doesn't do anything for us. The play is either Lizolda or Arena. I'm starting to lean towards Arena, even though I was thinking that it wasn't that good. But because he didn't actually do anything on his turn 3, like he didn't play a ramp spell or anything, and if we can Arena, and then, oh, Shizo Death Storehouse... We have the Hirobi combo. Yeah, it's close. Because Lizolda can actually attack through Sashi. Which is a thing. Seems important. Something that's kind of nice about this board state is that if my play is turn 4 Hirobi, at least it's like not leaving me open for much of a blowout. Like if he has a way of targeting multiple creatures. I think I just want to play Warren Power Stone here. So I can go Hirobi plus activate Shizo next turn. It's brutal. It gives him a turn with Sashi, but I think that's okay. Probably should have played Shizo there, actually. Now that I think about it, in case I hit the red one. Because if I... No, I would be... I'd be a mana short of playing Hirobi and then activating both of them. Okay. So that's not going to matter. The nice thing about playing Hirobi this turn is that you get to start attacking with him from the get-go. Like, I could be attacking him for 4 here. The nice thing about holding on to him and running out the Power Stone is that this way I can get an immediate activation out of Shizo. And then if the opponent has an answer to Hirobi, I can at least get my sweet, sweet Shizo value. I'm just going to activate that right now. The combos. I like that we have both legendary lands too. That's just adorable. Yeah. Cool. So if we just played Hirobi last turn, like we still would have found a Lightning Bolt to answer his Sashi, but I mean we would be in definitively worse shape. It's hard to argue with that. This thing flips over into three counters, right? Yeah. It's gonna play Gift. I think that's fine. His deck seems way worse without a Mirari's Wake in play. Like, it seems unbeatable for us with a Mirari's Wake in play, and it seems like unlosable without one. Vertiloth. And another Sashi. I guess there can be multiples. That's kind of weird. Or was this revealed? This was revealed till Illidamri's Call. This card can only get a land and a creature, so it just found him Myriad Landscape, which is pretty cool. It doesn't double fix, but it is card advantage, kind of like Krosan Verge. And then Vertiloth is a pretty good hit for him. Oh man, do I just play that? Got some options here. Because I can, like, flip my Liliana and start upticking it. Opponent has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 mana in play. 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, we'd be going Liliana, Lysolda, Sacrifice. Flip Liliana, uptick Liliana, discard a land. Which is a fine line. It's a fine line. Gets a Liliana in play. Starts pressuring his hand, like he needs to make land drops and play things to pressure me. Playing this card seems really strong. The only problem is if he has a piece of spot removal. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I'd be playing it as an 8/8. And then it'd be untapping with at least 4 activations. That could be huge. I like both of these lines. I kind of like waiting and then playing him and getting at least an activation or two out of him. An 8/8 ends the game really, really quickly with Shizo. I think I'm going to go for the cuter line. It's probably incorrect, but it's the line that I feel like making. It's like the idea of pressuring his hand. I'm actually going to discard Signet. He discards the Vertiloth. Sure. Yeah, so now that we have Liliana in play, assuming we get to untap with it, we can actually just, like, get back Hirobi and activate Shizo again. Like, that's just a thing we can do. But I'm probably just going to be, like, upticking Liliana, getting more cards out of his hand, playing Grenzo. One problem with playing Grenzo and activating it a bunch is that we have this arena going. We only have 20 cards left in our library, so there is a chance to deck out. It's not a very good chance, but it's a chance. I think I'm going to discard the Relic this turn. 5. Yeah, let's just do that. Getting to the point where we can start thinking about maybe beating an Eldrazi. Board presence is getting pretty strong. What did he discard that turn? Jareth, Leonine, Titan. It's a fine card, a little bit clunky. He could have played it last turn, right? Because he had this board state minus a card. Maybe he didn't have enough white. Maybe he just like fetched for double white there. But even then he had Prismatic Lens. So if it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, the Evolving Wilds isn't really a thing that he can tap. That matters. Oh, he's tapping mana, a chroma. Protection from black and from red. First Strike, Vigilance. I can kill that thing, right? Assuming he doesn't hit Liliana here. Yeah, because Hirobi doesn't target. Be interesting to see. Like, he kind of has to attack Liliana, but it'll be interesting to see if he knows that. Oh, he's attacking me. Alright. Don't think that's going to work out well for him. We don't know the rest of his hand, but... How close are we to just killing him? We can ping with Chandra. We only get one untap off of the Fiery Confluence. We can get back Lysolde with the Liliana. So we ping with Chandra, we copy Fiery Confluence. Copying Fiery Confluence is like infinite damage. Right, it's just 12. And then down ticking. Down ticking Liliana can get us back Lysolde, which is a lot of damage. And then this Chandra's gonna untap. And I believe that's just game. Not gonna get too cutesy when I have the win on board. Yeah, but we were still fine even if we didn't draw the burn spell that turn, because as I pointed out, we could have just gotten back Hirobi and then targeted his Achroma with Photoverse to give your Achroma first strike. Oh no, first strike, I'm dead! Like, that doesn't make much sense flavor wise. Hirobi's interesting, though. I'm glad we got a few of those combos together in that game 3. Yeah, the cube's been kind of fun so far. It hasn't been the most complicated cube. It hasn't been the most, like, refined, the most powerful. Well, it's been pretty powerful. But like I said earlier, there's a lot of individual cards with such a high power level. And there's a lot of, like, playing one card and winning the game because you played it and because your opponent can't deal with it. Yeah. And I think red is really undervalued right now. Like, I've been red both times and had a couple easy 3-0s just because it was open. So good luck cubing, guys. Good luck cubing.